Okay, I want to talk a little bit. Okay, so first of all, just stop here. Does anyone have any questions on all the policy stuff that we've covered? Does anyone want to jump in? Just in general, like if anyone ever has a question, just please like raise your hand and stop me, because I have a tendency to ramble. So you can definitely feel free to just interrupt me. Okay, so let's get into the schedule of how, and this is kind of a rough schedule. So basically we have 7 weeks here, and today we're more or less going to introduce neural networks. That's going to be like the second half of the course. Next week we're going to get into something called Wekinator. Wekinator is a really awesome application for doing machine learning. It's an application that takes care of all the machine learning stuff. It was made by a researcher named Rebecca Fiebrink, who's at Goldsmiths. Maybe some of you have seen this. She has a course on Cadenze.com for how to use Wekinator. Has like something like, it's a big MOOC and it has like 4,000 students or something. So a lot of people using it. This has been around for like 6-7 years. And what's really awesome about Wekinator and why I want to make it part of the course is that what it does is it accepts OSC messages, so Open Sound Control. Raise your hand if you know what Open Sound Control is. OSC. Okay, so most people. For those of you who don't know it, OSC is basically a data format that lets applications exchange data. So like different applications that are running either on one computer or on multiple computers over a network, they can exchange information with each other. So that makes it really easy to have applications that are sort of not designed to be working with each other. It makes it really easy to get them to talk to each other and interact. And what Wekinator does is it's like an interface that accepts in OSC messages from whatever applications that you use to get inputs. And then we will talk about more of what this means as we get into neural networks. But then it will output parameters that are also going through OSC to another application. So this lets you kind of like take whatever software that you use. If you're a musician and you're using like a lot of audio units and VSTs or Ableton, Max MSP, things like that, you can accept OSC messages or output them into Wekinator or from out of it, and then we can create all sorts of like really cool, it's like a big machine learning switchboard for real-time performance. So that should be really cool. We'll kind of do a demo here on how to use it. That'll be next week. The week three we're going to get into, I think we'll start this in week three, is going to be getting into convolutional neural networks, which is like a type of neural network that has become, in particular the last few years, has become super widely used. Convolutional neural networks are super, super amazing and flexible, and I'm going to, when I present, start talking about all these course materials, you'll see exactly why. Then we'll get into, like, we'll start to kind of get into application areas starting around week four. We'll start talking about unsupervised learning, which again, I'm going to describe in just a few minutes what that means, but basically it's a type of machine learning that deals with sort of, let's say, organizing and clustering data. Then the next 2 weeks are going to be sort of application areas. We're going to have Kyle McDonald here on the April 21st. I think a lot of you probably know him. He's a teacher here at ITP, and he does a lot of machine learning stuff also, super active. So he'll present something for like an hour. And then the last week is going to be reserved for student presentations. So and we'll figure out exactly what that looks like as we go. One other thing to look out for, and this is actually not even public yet, so you guys are in the end. We're going to be having we're going to have a conference about machine learning for artists that I've been helping to organize at SFPC, School for Poetic Computation, which is just a few blocks away from here. School for Poetic Computation is this really awesome, how many of you know SFPC? Okay, so some of you, those of you who don't, it's basically a small sort of alternative school that was started by Zach Lieberman, who founded Open Frameworks, and it's having a lot of events, and this will be one of them. We're going to have a bunch of speakers and stuff like that, and part of it is going to be a student exhibition, and so it'll be have an open call, so like if you have stuff that you start to work on for this course, it could be made part of the exhibit, so that's something to look out for. That's going to be in May 20th or 22nd. And again, like, yeah, all of this will be as you can see, this whole course is super, like, seat of our pants right now. So, but there's a lot of exciting stuff. It's super fast moving, so I think there's really no way around that. Okay, so, yeah, that's today. Okay, so the next thing I want to do is basically describe. So the next, maybe, like, I'll try to do this. Let's see, it's 3:40. Try to do over the next, like, 30 to 40 minutes, a basically big survey of all of the really exciting stuff that's happened with machine learning over the course of the last 2 years and even going back further. And then that'll be, like, that'll take us, let's say, 45 minutes. And then after that, we'll introduce neural networks a little more carefully and understand what they're doing. And that will kind of set the stage for next week when we start to use Reckonator. Does that sound good? Cool. I think that's, oops. Anyone have any questions?
Have you written down assignments?
Yes. Oh, right. I didn't even say. Yeah. I didn't get to all. It's okay. So assignments is also something we're gonna figure out as we go. I think what this week will probably maybe I'll just send an email after a course with maybe some suggested readings, and I think. After that, the assignments will, I'll try to set them up to, like, basically build upon what we do in course. So, like, when we do Wackinator next week, we'll try to assign, like, an application of that. I haven't thought about assignments too much. But in general, this is, like, this course is very much, like, what you make of it. So that's. And, of course, there will be the main gist of it, I'm hoping, is more the course project. I think that's kind of what I'm more excited about. And I wrote what's allowed, right? So, like, course projects are going to be what we present the last week. So that's, there's 15 people enrolled or something. So basically everyone would have something like 10 minutes, roughly, to present something that they've worked on for this course or, you know, that's just relevant to it. And... I'm gonna take a very broad approach to what's relevant. So, like, for those of you who want to do some sort of like an application using different like art platforms, things like that, definitely that will be probably the biggest component of the course. So that will be welcome. But also, like, I'm super interested in like there's a lot of like, and I'll be covering this as we go. But there are a lot of really great researchers that look into machine learning. And the sort of like, again, like things like ethics and policies and like how this integrates into society, things that I myself don't even do that much. So like I'm hoping that like some people who are really interested in that component will go deeper with that and then bring that to us. So again, I don't take a dogmatic approach to like what's relevant in the course. It's a really, really broad topic. And I'm just kind of showing you that about it, which I know, and hopefully people can bring other things to it. Okay. Yeah. Other questions? Okay, cool.
How about office hours?
Oh, office hours. So I don't have any in theory right now, but that maybe is something that might be a good idea to set up. Let me make a note of that. Office hours. Let's do office hours. I was even thinking about like trying to do a lab session or something, but then the room space became super complex. Office hours. Silence. Let me get back to you guys.
Do you guys?
Oh yes. Oh yeah. This is basically it. The reason why it's not much more detailed right now is because. We'll kind of make it up as we go. I want to kind of get a feel for the class, like how fast it's moving. The first thing I mentioned to everyone was that this is the first time teaching the subject. Like I've taught before, but not machine learning, so it's very seat of my pants. So like, so just bear with me. Very experimental. So office hours, assignments. Okay. Okay. So here's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna present to you some. Basically a big presentation of all of the things that we're going to cover. Oh, but doesn't start there. How many of you guys use Open Frameworks? All right. Home base. And wait, this is also still wrong. Okay, good. Okay. Oops. Yeah, this is actually, someone made this yesterday. This is what's called a variational autoencoder, and it's trained on my face. That's like sort of me, maybe. Melting into different kinds of people. We'll get into that later. So like just a little, like the 5 seconds about me. I used to do like music information retrieval, which I was doing here, in fact, here at NYU, like about 5 years ago at Steinhardt, near neighboring Steinhardt, working for this company called Sourcetone, whose research department was headed by Juan Bello and Robert Rowe at Steinhardt. I don't know if you guys are affiliated with them, if you know them. And music information retrieval is sort of like applied machine learning into music. So I was doing things like trying to cluster genres together, assign emotion labels to music so that you could build playlists off of it. So this was kind of like a past life 5 years ago before I started doing more art stuff. Machine learning was totally different at this time. Like everything that we were doing has been deemed obsolete, and we'll kind of see why as we go into it. But there are lots of cool things, like you cluster genres together and so on. So this is machine learning in a nutshell. So traditionally, when people introduce the notion of machine learning, we kind of have three, like this is breaking down to some degree, but like traditionally there's been three notions of machine learning. There's classification, there's supervised and unsupervised learning, and then there's reinforcement learning. Supervised learning is this. Suppose you have a bunch of data and you want to be able to figure out, and it has categories, so it has labels. So you have data points and labels. And you want to build an algorithm which can tell you, for any given sample, what label it has. So it's kind of like pattern recognition, right? So this is like a really, really basic example of it. And so let me give you like a concrete example. So suppose that you're interested in speculating about the cost of houses or something. That's regression. Suppose that you're a doctor and you're getting patients and you want to have an algorithm which tells you whether or not they're going to acquire heart disease or something. So it's like a label. Sorry for the morbid example. It's just like it actually is a really good example. And you have patient records. So you have like people's height and their weight and their blood pressure and all sorts of like biometric data. So you have all these columns of data and you have rows of patients, right? And for the patients that you know about, you have labels like this person got heart disease and this person didn't, something like that. I'm not a doctor, so I know it's much more complicated, but just use your imagination. So we want to create an algorithm which takes all of our data, like let's say we get a new patient, and we can measure all those things about them, their height, their weight, and so on. And then we want to infer whether or not they will get a heart attack or something, or get a heart disease. So can we learn from the previous data and build a predictive function which tells you whether or not they will get a heart attack based on their, based on all those things? So we kind of have some intuitions about it. We know that some of the data points are correlated with heart disease, right? We might think like blood pressure is correlated with heart disease, things like that. But the way that those numbers interact can be really, really complex and nonlinear and have all sorts of weird interactions. And so it's impossible to like create sort of an algorithm by hand that goes, okay, well, if they have this much blood pressure, but their weight is like this, it's just impossible, right? We want to create algorithms which learn from that data and then create a function which is then able to accurately predict. So that's what classification means, or supervised learning. That's classification, which is a type of supervised learning. Another type of supervised learning is basically the same thing, except instead of categories of data, we have one continuous variable that we're trying to predict, and that's called regression. A lot of people, like if you've taken like a statistics course in high school or college, you've probably done this by hand. So it's really, that's machine learning. You're creating a predictive function. So for example, with this, housing prices, right? So you have a data set of houses, and you know how many rooms they have, and how many bathrooms they have, and what they're made out of, and what their location is, and so on, and you know what they cost. So if you get a new housing sample, can you predict what it costs from the data? So we do this, we sort of do this implicitly when we think about it, right? You look at the, you look at all those characteristics and you go, I think a house costs whatever. But can you do it algorithmically and more accurately? So that's supervised learning. These two things are supervised learning. And actually what we'll see later in the course is that these two things can be used together too. They're not necessarily two separate tasks. We can create systems which make use of both. And then unsupervised learning is basically when you have data that has no labels. So you're interested in organizing that data or sort of understanding the distribution. And we'll see some examples of that. So like this is a famous example called, an algorithm called k-means clustering. So k-means cluster says, okay, let's say you have a bunch of random points. Can you figure out, can you assign them to categories, assign them to clusters based on how close they are to each other? So that's a type of unsupervised learning. Another one is like self-organizing maps are a type of unsupervised learning, which basically take a data distribution and sort of organize it. We'll see that later actually. Also like different algorithms, different things can do both. So like neural networks are capable of doing classification and regression, and they can also be used to do clustering and supervised learning. So that's like something called autoencoders, which we might may or may not see a little bit of. That's kind of machine learning in a nutshell. Okay, so this is what we're going to do today. And I'm going to talk about it very briefly, and then after we're done the whole survey, I'll come back to this basically. Neural networks are the main type of supervised learning algorithm we're going to cover because they have been, well, there's a few reasons. Number one, they're actually quite, I think, compared to most other types of supervised learning algorithms, they're actually pretty easily understood with like more or less high school math. So we can understand them at a pretty deep level, I think. They're also really, really in the news a lot lately. So neural networks, like when I was doing that MIR stuff that I was showing you, neural networks were considered to be dead. Like I was told by all my professors, like, oh, don't use neural networks. Everyone thinks they're terrible. They're not effective. And unbeknownst to me, that was changing in academia at that time. Where neural networks started to make a huge comeback because we basically figured out how to train them properly. And we'll see later in the, probably later today, why that is. So neural networks have come back and they, in 2009, particularly like convolutional neural networks, which we'll cover later in the course, became the best algorithms for doing speech recognition, so text, audio to text. And then in 2012, convolutional neural networks won the ImageNet competition. ImageNet competition is an annual competition in computer vision where there's a big famous data set called ImageNet that has 1,000 categories of images that are all that are labeled, basically. And the challenge is, can you accurately classify them? And up until that point, all of the approaches used were traditional computer vision based approaches for classifying images, and at that time, like the top, the best systems had a 26% error in top five. So what that means is, if their system gets five guesses, there's 1,000 categories, you get five guesses. The best systems were able to get basically 75%, roughly 74% within their top five, which is pretty good. In 1 year, when the first convolutional neural network was entered, it went from 25% error to 15% error. So like a 10% drop in 1 year, which is like unheard of in academia for that kind of drop. And since then, and that was a convolutional neural network. Since then, all of the entries are now convolutional neural networks. And they've continuously dropping. So now, like the most recent winner, I think was Baidu, had their ResNet, which has like 150 layers. We'll talk about what that means. And it has some mind-boggling like 5% error or something. So it's really, really huge. It's like basically everyone in computer vision and outside of computer vision, like called it a revolution basically in computer vision. Like we basically just trashed all these old techniques, and we're in the process of sort of integrating them into all the applications. So, and what's interesting, I just mentioned audio and image, right? One architecture, one algorithm, two completely different domains. And convolutional neural networks are also used, they were used for those of you, anyone following the whole AlphaGo thing, the human Go player was defeated by a computer playing Go, that was last week. So that also makes use of convolutional neural networks, so they're super, super general and broad, and so they're really interesting, and we'll talk about them more carefully. So this is Ada Lovelace describing neural networks like 100 years before anyone had a name for them. Ada Lovelace is commonly called like the first software programmer in the history of computer science because she basically devised a machine to devised an algorithm to calculate Bernoulli numbers, which is this. And actually, when she was describing building the what was called the analytical engine, that was like Charles Babbage's device, which she wanted to build her whole life. She talked about it much like a neural network, I think. So I found these quotes. It were much to be desired that when mathematical processes pass through the human brain instead of through the medium of inanimate mechanism, it were equally a necessity of things that the reasonings connected with operations should hold the same just place as a clear and well-defined branch of the subject of analysis, fundamental but yet independent ingredient in the science which they must do in studying the engine. That's the analytical engine. So neural networks were sort of like... neural networks are more formally described about in the 1950s, roughly, which is when perceptrons, I'll talk about this in a second, so they kind of go back to the 1950s to perceptrons, which were invented by this scientist named Frank Rosenblatt. And perceptrons were these binary bits, which would pass information to each other, and they were very loosely inspired by the brain. So what we know about the brain is that you have trillions of neurons in your brain, and they all have the capacity to fire electrical impulses to each other. And so, like, if you go from this kind of, so like you pass, I'm not a neuroscientist, so like you can pass signals through what's called dendrites coming from the neural network and passing into another neuron. And one neuron will collect signals from another, like a set of neurons, and it will sum it up. And then there's some sort of what's called an action potential, which is like taking all of that electrical impulses, how much of it does it sort of fire onto the next, wherever it's also firing to? So you can kind of go from this to this, which still describes the cell body, and then you can see the correspondence to this, which is basically what neural networks look like. The reason why they were... such conceived is because they're incredibly flexible. They can model extremely complex input to output relationships, which is what is necessary for them to do. I'm going to show you a little demo in just a second of how they work. Just before, just think if there's any aspects of this that are important. I should just say, don't take the analogy too far, or you will make the cognitive scientists very unhappy, because they're really inspired by the brain, but like machine learning scientists have all but sort of abandoned we're not trying to model the brain. We're trying to outdo it, actually. So I'm not doing a bad job, actually, recently. I'm going to show you a little demo, okay? So... all of this is going to be in the notes on that ML4A, and that's actually online now. I'll share all the links with you guys after the course. Okay, so I'm just going to show you this. This is a simple forward pass. Okay, so this is a neural network, and this is a really simple one, right? So these are called neurons, so these circles. These connections, can everyone see that? Should I make it a little bigger? Is that good? Okay. So you have these connections between them. And the way an ordinary neural network works is that you have it basically in a series of layers. So this is the input layer of neurons. And then this is the middle layer of neurons. I just realized I'm actually doing basically the third component in the middle of this. So maybe what we'll do is... Okay. I think this will make sense to basically, I'll do the third component of the course now in the process of this, and then this will just be longer. Okay, that makes sense. Sorry about thinking out loud. So yeah, back to the neural networks. You have three neurons in this, what's called the input layer. And then you have them arranged in layers. So the signal will kind of go sequentially from the leftmost layer to the rightmost layer. And so this is what's called a two-layer neural network. It looks like it has three, but we only count layers that have connections going to them. So this is a two-layer neural network because basically it has two hops. And it has one what's called a hidden layer. So this is a hidden layer, which sounds very mysterious, but it just means that it's not an input or an output. And then we have one output layer. This can have more than one neuron. Just for the sake of simplicity, I have one right now, but it can have more than one. This is basically just a framework for taking an input of information, which looks like this. So let's say you get some random numbers, and propagating it from left to right. And the way that the math works, I'll have to make this a little smaller. So you start with this input, right? Each of these connections has a weight value, right? So when we do the first pass, we basically start with the first neuron here, the first neuron in the hidden layer, and the calculation goes like this. You take each value, you multiply it times the weight, and you do that for each of these, and then you add them up. So it's a weighted sum, right? So it's 0.33 times 0.15, negative 0.3 times 0.74, negative 0.13 times 0.6. So these get all added up. And then there's one more term that gets added, which is called a bias term, and we'll talk about why it's called that. But basically, there's a bias term. So this is basically, you can see the computation here. 0.15 times 0.33, 0.74 times negative 0.3, and so on, right? And then we calculate this value to that neuron. And then there's one more thing that happens, right? So this, I actually don't even write, I don't have it written what the final value is, but so that's just the raw sum. But almost always there's also what's called an activation function, which is basically takes whatever value has been accumulated in a neuron and transforms it somehow. And usually it's like these days we use what are called ReLU, which is basically just lets it pass. Except if it's negative, it just makes it zero. But it used to be common to use the sigmoid function. Let me show you what that looks like, actually, because I have here. Yes, all of these notes are here, so these are also, they're a little disorganized right now. I apologize. I'll be kind of organizing them as we go. So activation function, so one is like this. So imagine, let me first get back to this. So imagine here, like this can be, whatever these are, it's essentially unbounded, right? It can take an arbitrarily large sum of numbers or an arbitrarily small number. Often we want to squash it. So we use what's called the sigmoid function, which is this. It's 1 over 1 plus e to the negative z. E is the exponential constant. You guys are familiar with that. It's, I think Euler came up with it, right? It's like 2.71. You can get it from an infinite expansion, infinite series expansion. What it does is we use it because it has two properties that we like. One is that it takes whatever goes into the neuron and it squashes it between 0 and 1, which is really helpful for various reasons that will become clearer when we get into actual applications. But also, it makes it nonlinear. So this notion of linearity in math, and a lot of you are probably familiar with it, you kind of learn it in high school, a linear function is one where the value of the function is proportional to each of the inputs individually, each of the variables individually, and it changes flat. It's like flat, right? So a line, right? If you do y equals 3x plus 2, that's a line, right? So it will change by a constant amount all the time. And if you have, like, you could have multiple variables, you could have, like, z equals 3x plus 5y, that's also still linear. It's not a line anymore, it's a plane, but it's still flat. And you can do this in as many variables as you want. So you can have a big space of 1,000 dimensions, and you would have what's called a hyperplane, which is that many dimensions minus one. You know, that's basically like it's the equivalent of flat in that space. We can't see it anymore, but it's the same in any number of dimensions, which is nice. Making it nonlinear basically is what allows us to model any arbitrary input to any arbitrary output. So remember looking back at our housing prices and our other examples, we need an algorithm which is capable of modeling as flexible as possible, because we don't know what the character of the data, how we want to discriminate inside of it, how it's going to look, and so it needs to be flexible. And so we like to use nonlinear models for this. Nonlinear can be painful for mathematicians because it makes everything much harder to solve analytically. But because we're not doing math here, we don't care. So that's going to be okay for us. But basically so this is actually not going to be super important for us to know, but just for the sake of kind of trying to describe how these things work. So the sigmoid function was used for a long time, but it kind of fell out of favor for reasons that are a little bit beyond the scope of the class. Basically, like that they become super flat here is kind of not a great property about them. It makes them hard to train. Something called vanishing gradient it makes them basically hard to train. I should be using this other computer. So now we use these, which are actually simpler. These are called rectified linear units, which is a really, really complicated name for something that's incredibly simple. All it does is it takes whatever goes into the neuron, and it just lets it go. Unless it's negative, then it makes it zero. So it just takes it squashes it at zero. These look linear, you know, it looks like a line, but it's considered nonlinear because of this point. This makes it non-differentiable, which means you can't do calculus on it, but we have ways of dealing with that too. So basically this right here is using our sigmoid function, so all of the outputs are squashed between 0 and 1. So we do this for both of these neurons, right, same computation, and then finally now we have values for these two. And we output it to the next one. This is our output, our final output. So basically what we just did, this is called a forward pass. So you'll hear this a lot. So like when a neural network takes an input and propagates it forward through all the layers to the final layer, it's called forward propagation. And it's basically the way that we take information, our inputs, and propagate them through our network, and then we get output information. And we'll talk about how to interpret that output information in the next section. So that's a forward pass. Does anyone have questions about forward passes? Does it make sense
to
everyone?
The B variable?
Okay. B, it stands for bias. So basically, all of these have weights, right? And then every neuron also, except for the input neurons, have a bias term associated with it, which basically says whatever this input receives, add this much to it at the end. It basically makes them, it's equivalent to like, you know, if you have, you know, y equals 3x plus, or let's say you have z equals 5x plus 4y. The bias term, it's b, right? It's like mx plus b, it's like this, you know, 3. So basically, whatever value we get from the weights and the inputs, we just offset it by some arbitrary amount. So that gives the model, again, a little bit more flexibility, and also because sometimes it's useful because this is a little abstract until we see applications, but sometimes we want neurons to be like sort of reluctant to fire, or, you know, like, the bias, you know, they require more input. And actually, it turns out the neurons in the brain are similar. They have something like this. They have a sort of tendency to not fire at all times. Cool. Good. Okay, cool. Let's get back to this. Okay, so now let's use a neural network in practice. So what we're going to do is we're going to use it to classify handwritten digits. So for those of you who have been following sort of, who have seen machine learning stuff before, especially online, this is a very classic problem and is actually used a lot in teaching. We have a data set called MNIST, M-N-I-S-T, which is a big data set of handwritten digits that were compiled, I think, in like the 1980s or something, that were, you know, we had people come in and they drew samples of handwritten digits, and then we have labels for them too. So like we have this big data set that says this image of someone's handwritten three is a three. So we have the labels and we have the images. So it's a useful data set for us to consider the problem of how do we make a machine learning algorithm learn the label of handwritten digits, can you read handwritten digits and figure out what numbers they are? So that's a really good problem for a neural network to solve. And it turns out that neural networks are used to solve this problem. So this is how it works, how we set it up. So we have we set up a neural network which has at its input layer the same number of neurons that there are pixels in this image. So the MNIST images are 28 by 28 pixels, so that's 784 pixels, and they're grayscale, they're binary, right? So there's 784 numbers which describe this image, and they look like this, right? So those of you, probably this is a review for everyone, but the way we store images is in red, green, and blue values if they're color, or if they're grayscale, we just have one value, which is the brightness, and it goes from 0 to 255, where 255 is the brightest, so that's white. Everyone's familiar with that, right? You've used processing and so on, so... you can represent it as 0 to 1 if you want, doesn't matter. But basically, you take all of these and you input them into the first layer of the neural network. So remember our forward pass? That would be our input values. And then, this is actually cut off, but basically, actually I'll just get, to, yeah, okay. This is the way we would set it up. So the digit would go into the first layer of the neural network. There's 784 inputs. And let's say in this one, we set it up in the following way. We'll have one hidden layer of neurons, which has 15 neurons, and don't worry about why we chose that number, it's basically arbitrary, but we'll talk about how to select that later. But just for the time being, this example has 15 neurons in the hidden layer, and then it has 10 neurons in the output layer. And it has 10 neurons because we have 10 kinds of labels. We have the 10 digits, right? 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And so the way we interpret this, the neural network, is in the following way. We input the number, we input the image into the network, we do a forward pass into it, and then at the end, all 10 of these neurons have a value, and whichever one scores the highest, is the classification that we make for this number. So this one happened to go through this network, it's already been trained. It goes through the network and it receives a score of 0.86 for 9 and kind of has small ones for the others. And you see it maybe got a little bit of signal for 4, could almost be a 4, but we know that it's a 9, so we got it correct, right? So basically, this is the way we set up a neural network for classification. However many categories we have in our data set, we have that many output neurons, and then we do a forward pass, and we observe which of these has the highest score, basically, and then our classification is that.
Can I ask?
Yeah.
You mentioned a data set that it's going to look at when you read this, right? So it has a data set with a lot of different cases of handwriting where they know like this number is equal to 3, this number is equal to 5. Is that rightly understood? Is that correct? Like that there's a data set beneath it?
Yeah, we have this data set, yeah.
Right.
It's called MNIST.
How many cases are there?
So that data set contains, I think, like 60,000 samples. I believe 60,000 samples that were collected and had people, random people, draw them. And then someone, like a human, labeled all of them.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So one thing, I'm going to show you guys a demo of this. So I have, again, this is another one of the demos that I'm working on. This is online. We're looking at my local copy, but this is actually also online. I'll share the links after class. Basically, I missed forward pass. Okay, so right now it's training. I'm going to describe this in just a second, how training works, and what training is, actually, because we haven't talked about that yet. But this is what we just saw. So I can do a... I shouldn't do a space bar because it keeps on. this is classifying. Okay, look, this one got incorrect, right? So this looks to me like a 5, and we know it's a 5 because the 5 is in green, and it misclassified it as looks like a 3 or a 0, and you can kind of see why. You know, it has some things in common, right? Any human would look at this and see this is a 5, but our neural network screwed up. But it's usually pretty good. I mean, we can actually do a lot better than the one we saw. This is actually a really bad neural network, like on purpose. This is like poorly trained. We can see a lot more mistakes. Okay, this one's really bad. This labeled as 2. It thinks it's a 2. And 7 got almost nothing. So,
are you just grabbing images randomly from that data?
From the
data set,
mm-hmm. Yeah. And actually, let me also... I just thought to do this, so I'm going to quickly change this so that it's not trained, basically. I'm going to train it on a really small amount. Sorry. I just want you guys to see what it looks like if we don't train it very much. This is the implementation. Load MNIST. So let's just do like... 105. So now this will be like really poorly trained, I think. Uh-oh. 400 of 200. I need a few more of these. Okay, let's do like 200. Wait, I have a bug. Okay, never mind. let me describe what would have happened if I had figured out to do this before. the first class is it would have just been really bad. Basically, it would have classified poorly. And what did I break this? Let's change. How many was it? There's 21. Yeah. Okay. So yeah, it just would have been performing badly. But basically, the next thing I want to talk about is training and what that means. Okay. Let me get back to the slides. Oh, did I close the slides? Okay. I'll show you that in a second. Okay, so what happens is if we look at that first demo, right, it was just giving us some random junk, right? So when we start with a neural network that's untrained, we just give it random weights, right? So we can imagine that if we don't train a network and we just put random weights there and we start throwing images into it, it'll just give us random values at the outputs, right? So it's not going to do anything interesting. It'll just give us random values. We need to train the network. Training it means we want to show it how to give us a high value for nines when we put in various images of nines, and how to give us a high value for fives when we give it various images of fives and so on, right? The network's not going to know how to do this immediately. It's just going to have a bunch of random weights, so we'll get random values. We have to set the weights in such a way that it will do what we want it to do, which is output nines when we see nines and so on. This process is called training the network, and the way we do it is using data. So we have this big data set that contains lots of samples of the numbers, and when we input them, we have their labels, so we can create a framework for training the neural networks in such a way that works like this. We go, okay, give it all of these numbers and their labels, and the network, tell the network to adjust all of the weights so that that it outputs it in the way that we want it to. Does that make sense? I know that's a little wordy. Sorry?
How do you adjust weight? Like,
yeah. So I'm gonna talk about that. So actually, so here's the thing about training the network. For the purposes of this class, we're not gonna look at it very deeply, and I'll tell you why. Number one, it's a this class is gonna focus more on applications. So we're gonna mostly work with already trained neural networks. Training is something that is also like a little bit like more complicated mathematically and as far as engineering goes, than just understanding what we've shown so far. And so we're just not gonna look at it very carefully. I'm basically gonna give you a very, like an abstract explanation of how the training process works so that we can understand it a little bit. Training is basically the central question in scientific research with neural networks. So it is a very interesting thing. And so I would definitely like, people might actually find a reason to pursue it for like a course project actually, or some aspect of it. That might be a really good course project actually, like a good demonstration of training, because I've been struggling with how to explain it myself. Basically, here's how it works in the most abstract sense. The technique is that is dominant today is called back propagation. So we talked about forward propagation. Back propagation is its counterpart. It is sort of this process where we take the information and we propagate it backwards, back to the inputs, to figure out how to adjust the weights. As you accomplished using another method, which I'll describe in a second, called gradient descent or stochastic gradient descent. So the intuition is like this. Let's say we take a sample of a 9 and we pass it through the network. And we get a whole bunch, and it's not trained yet, so we'll just get a whole bunch of random values, and you know they'll mostly be incorrect. And we want to go, okay, well, we want, for this sample, we want the score for 9 to be higher than it is, and the scores for the others to be lower than they are. So the question is, how do we change all of the weights so as to get that, right? And now you might be thinking, well, why not change it by a lot? And the reason is because we don't know how, because we have to do it using a way that's practical, which involves kind of making small adjustments. The reason why we can't change all the weights at once is because it's highly difficult to understand how all of the different weights and how they combine will create a set of outputs. So imagine we change this weight right here, like this top one. Well, that changes, that we can see the change, at least on this layer, is only for this neuron, right? Because this connection only goes here, and it doesn't go into any of these others, right? But this neuron goes into all of these, right? And so changing this value will change all of these also. And so the process of changing weights is highly chaotic. You change one weight by a little bit, and it changes the performance of the whole network, right? And so the only way for us to kind of work is to kind of make small steps that we can observe and then keep on making small steps. So there's a really good analogy that's often used in courses to describe it. And actually, like, you'll see why it's called gradient descent. So imagine like you're a mountain climber, right? And you're on top of a mountain and it's night. And it's become dark, and you need to get down to your base camp, right? But you can't see anywhere around you. You can only see like the ground around your feet, right? So how would you get down? Well, you can look around you and figure out which way is going the most downhill, and step forward in that direction, and then look around you again, and then see which way is going the most downhill, step forward in that direction, and you do this repeatedly. And sure enough, you eventually kind of make your way down the mountain and get to the bottom, right? So this sounds like super remote from everything that we've been talking about, but here's how it applies. you can interpret it in the following way. Every dimension that we're on this mountain, so imagine there's like, you can either go north-south or east-west on the mountain, right? North-south is like, imagine it's a graph. North-south is one weight. So if you move forward, you make the weight bigger. And if you go backward, you make that weight smaller. And the other direction is a second weight. So this way, the weight goes bigger. This way, the weight goes smaller, right? So that's just two weights, right? But just imagine we have two weights, right? So, and the elevation, right, of our mountain is the amount of error that we get in our neural network. And we want it to be as low as possible. So we change the weights slightly by moving like a little bit this way and a little bit this way, such that we go downhill. And we can figure out how it changes effectively using calculus, basically. Again, like, we won't cover this stuff in too much detail just because it's a little bit beyond the scope of the course. But again, just for metaphor's sake, it's nice to know about. And then we kind of do this repeatedly until we reach the bottom. And this is how a neural network is trained. So, ta-da.
Even if you use the same training data, mm-hmm. because each model starts with different random weights, mm-hmm. each model would behave slightly differently, even with the same training data. Or would they reach a point where it's like mathematically not that different?
If you set the weights differently, you may achieve a totally different set of weights, which might have the same accuracy. So if you think about it in terms of the mountain analogy, like, the lowest downhill point might occur in many different places. So you can actually have many different sets of weights, in fact, possibly infinite sets of weights, that achieve a similar accuracy. Ta-da, because we won't say too much more about training. It's a really interesting process, and part of the notes, I'll include some resources for those of you who are interested more about it. There's a few really good lectures online which describe how training works more effectively. And I'm also putting that into the book. The book will have more stuff than we have time to cover in the course, so that will be one of the components. Let's look inside neural networks a little bit. These look kind of interesting to you. Squint a little bit, they might look like something. So let me go back to the demos. I just made this today, actually. So, okay. Actually, I want to pause this before the reveal happens. Okay, you guys can basically see what's going on. These are forming these images, and I'm going to describe what they are. They're forming into what look like the digits if you squint a little bit. What are we looking at? Okay, so this one right here, so this is our network, right? Now imagine for a second we don't have a hidden layer, that we just have a network that looks like this. We have 784 pixels and 10 output neurons, right? So there's no hidden layer. So into this neuron, which is assigned 0, it has connections from all 784 pixels. Right, so there's 784 weights going into it. They're not all drawn here, right? I have a ellipsis here. But each of these are taking 784 weights. The weights are themselves kind of revealing, right? Because we've taken all of these pixels and we've unrolled them, right? But we can roll them back. We can visualize them as in the way that they're configured before, which is in terms of the image, right? We have this 28 by 28 image. And each of the pixels in the image have a corresponding weight. So you can visualize the weights in the same way. And we can color the weights the way we would color the images. So they'd be higher or lower, depending on the intensity of the pixel is how big the weight is, right? So like this, if we look at, like, let's say this pixel right here, this is going to be the value of the first weight. The value of the first weight, which is this, right? So it probably has some low value, right? And then the second pixel is going to be the value of the weight for the second pixel, and the third pixel, and so on, right? Now, why do they these weights, this is the process of training. This is actually the network is being trained, right? Why do these images, why do the weights, if you visualize them this way, why do they end up looking a little bit like the image classes, sort of? Does anyone want to take a stab at that? Why would the weights look this way? Like, why do they look like the image classes?
Because the change is not a lot from the source. So
mm-hmm.
it kind of looks like the source, like the image source.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, yeah.
Kind of paints on top of the same image over again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so doing something like that. So basically, remember the operation, the actual mathematical operation, when we looked at the forward pass. The way we get the value here is we take the pixel, multiply it by this weight, then take this pixel, multiply it by this weight, this pixel, multiply it by this weight, and then we sum all of those together. Right? So it's pixel times weight plus pixel times weight plus pixel times weight, and so on. So when pixels in the original input image are high, we would like for, let's see, this is hard to word properly, because it actually turns out to be really simple to understand, but hard to describe verbally. I should make a better visual for this. But basically, like, we want these weights to be high for the corresponding pixels for which tend to be high in the input image. Does that make sense? So like you see a lot of white around this value, right? Because because images of zeros tend to have high pixels here. And they tend to have low pixels here. And they also tend to have low pixels here, but that's not black, and I'll describe why in a second. But basically, if our weights are sort of like, how do you turn off those stupid notifications from Facebook? I don't even know. They've been doing that for like a year. I don't even log on ever. Anyway, I'm sorry about that. My outburst. I'll contain my outburst. So if we want the weights to be sort of like, we want the weights to be sort of sympathetic to the images, you might say, is another way of putting it. We want them to be high when the pixels of the input images are high, because then we multiply a high number times a high number, we get an even higher number, and so this ends up having a high score. And we want it to be low for pixels that aren't in zeros, because then it doesn't get that score. So if we do that for each of these, then images that look like twos, you can imagine I'm getting an idea for a good visual actually already. So like overlaying, if you overlay a two, let's say we get an image of a two and we like overlay it on top of this, we'll see that some of the two lines up with these high pixels, and so it will contribute to the sum a decent amount, but a lot of the two will be wasted on these weights, because it appears where the weights are kind of low. And it will be the same for all of these other images, but for the two, it will line up really well, right? So like it'll have kind of a high bit here and kind of going off in this direction. So that's kind of nice, because then we are sort of hedging our bets that twos will tend to line up their pixels the most with these pixels, these weight pixels, and get high score for those, and then get lower scores for all the other image classes. Does that make sense? Any questions? I should try and find a better way to explain these, but it's something like that. So you can think of these kind of as templates, you know? So like we're looking at a zero that no one actually drew, but it's kind of like your average zero. A neural network is trying to like have a high value for pixels that tend to have a lot of zeroness on top of them. And this is kind of neat to look at too. And it's also, I should say, it's a hint of things to come. So when we get into like all of the cool visual applications of neural networks and later in this chapter, so all the deep dream and style transfer stuff. It's really kind of this, an over-glorified version of what we just did, which is looking at what's inside the neural networks and bringing out these templates. So it, you know, the neural network kind of thinks it knows what a 3 looks like. And so we'll kind of see this in a little bit more advanced form later. Yep.
Is the bias just a part of the general idea of the weight?
So the bias, the bias, if you think about it, so this is just a visualization of the weights, so you don't see the bias in it. But the bias, like, let's say our data set had tons of zeros and much less of the others, then you might expect to find a high bias for the zero term, because then it like requires less to have it. It's like having a handicap. You know, it just has an artificially high value. So that's like kind of prior information. That's like one use of the bias. Yeah.
So like, why is there so much like kind of like gray around? Wouldn't you expect that to be like just much darker on the perimeter?
So that's a good question. So when I first saw these, I also asked the same question: why aren't these all black, right? Because you see a lot of black in here, right? The reason is because these pixels on the perimeter on the outside tend to be black for all of the image classes, right? So the neural network doesn't learn to deweight these, right? Because it's no additional information that there's no pixels here, and so they end up being just noisy. They're sort of like not important, kind of. And what's really important is the pixels that tend to be high in zeros and not high in others, and that tend to be low in zeros and not low, right? So that's why you have a lot of black here. That's an interesting example of this, comes with the 9. If you look at the weight for the 9, it seems to be missing this part of it, right? Like we see 9s that usually have a leg kind of thing, but it doesn't seem to appear in this. And the reason is because it also appears in too many of the other digits. So like 7s have them, 1s have these legs, right? So like there's not as much information to this weight set to try to discriminate a 9 from non-9s to make these high weights. It really goes like, there's actually tends to be a lot of 8-9 confusion in these kinds of neural networks. So that's a sort of rough explanation of weights. And what they do, that's where we're at with weights. Yeah, so these are just these cases. Okay, so let me just see where we are. So basically, what I just described are neural networks. I should show you some fun demos that I've made also. So before we move on to convolutional neural networks, because most of today is about neural networks in general, I just want to show you some more demos that'll help us look at the performance of these. So this, I just actually just put this online. Doesn't display very well, it's not bad. Okay, so this is doing a live classification of MNIST digits. It's doing it in JavaScript, by the way, which is super, I'm like still reeling from the idea that we can have these in JavaScript. Technically, what we have here is not a neural network, but a convolutional neural network, and so the accuracy is much higher. We're going to talk about convolutional neural networks in a second, but I just want to show you this visualization because to describe a little bit about like what we look for in terms of evaluation. So this is labeling these on the fly, and this is what's called a confusion matrix. So basically, the rows are zero actual numbers. So this row corresponds to actual zeros. These are actual ones, actual twos, and so on. And then the columns are our predictions, right? So the diagonal is correct ones. These are zeros that we correctly classified, ones that are correctly classified. And you see that all of the images that are correctly classified tend to be perfect. You know, they're like perfect digits. And so they're really easy to classify. If we look at some of the mistakes, so for example, these are fives that were misclassified for sixes. You can kind of see why that would happen, right? So some of these do look kind of confusing. In fact, if I look at the first one myself, I might think of it as a six. So sometimes these computers, they make mistakes that we would otherwise make ourselves. This is a good one. So these are the top mistakes. So this one was predicted as a two. Kind of see why, right? There has this sort of the two ish shape. These are eights misclassified as nines, which there's quite a lot of. Not so many nines misclassified as eights, interestingly. I'm sorry, what was the question? Four? Which are you talking about? Four? Oh, the top one? Oh, this one? Predict. Oh, interesting. Okay. Yeah, that looks like a seven to me also. So it turns out that the MNIST data set itself, I think, has some errors. So I think this right here is probably a seven that was mislabeled by a human as a four. And now it's part of the ground truth data. I'm glad you pointed that out, actually, because that is something that happens in MNIST. And there's, I think, a few digits which have been seen. So, first of all, I mean, it's, you know, humans are labeling this. Humans are going to make mistakes, too. If you get 60,000 numbers, I guarantee you that you'll get at least a few dozen of them wrong. And so, especially if you have to label lots of them. So there actually are some errors in labels also. This should be correct in my view. And I think pretty much everyone's. I'm going to show you another data set. This is the same thing, except using a data set that's more complicated called CIFAR. So CIFAR stands for Canada something. I forgot exactly. Doesn't even say what it stands for here. Anyway, it's a data set of 32 by 32 pixel images consisting of airplanes, automobiles, birds, cats, deer, dogs, frogs, horses, ships, and trucks. And they kind of look like this. So you can see that like frogs and dogs and deer and so on. Now, if we do the same thing, except instead of with our handwritten digits, we do it with these. You'll see, first of all, that the performance of the network is much, much less. Now, first of all, I want to make one note that, first of all, these are in color, right? So that will complicate things a little bit already, and I'll describe how we deal with that in a second. But let's describe why. So this accuracy dips now. It was like 98% for the numbers, and now it's like 58% for these. And actually, I think it might be overfitting, which means that the accuracy is actually less. So we can think of some reasons why we expect these to perform a little bit worse. One reason is that we have colors now, so that complicates our data representation a little bit. I'll show you how we can kind of deal with that. Another reason is that compared to numbers, these classes of images have a lot more diversity in the way that they may appear in images. So if you look at cats, like some of the, you know, images of cats, of course, cats, you see that they like appear in all sorts of different positions. They're facing different directions. They might be outstretched. They might appear at different sizes in the image. They might have different surroundings. There's like other things inside of the images too. So there's all of these things that complicate the problem that we didn't see in MNIST. In MNIST, we had perfect, you know, there's no background noise. There's only one color. You know, you don't have to recognize nines when they're backwards, right? But you do have to recognize cats when they're facing a different direction. So now we have a lot more to sort of deal with in terms of the internal diversity of the data, and so our performance dips off when we use a. And actually, I should say that this accuracy right here is only using a convolutional neural network. Both of these are using convolutional neural networks, which I haven't even described yet, and I'm going to in a minute. If we use the ordinary neural network that I just showed with the MNIST digits, we would have an accuracy of around 90%, which is pretty respectable, I think. 90, maybe like 88. That's not too bad, right? Random guesses would be 10%. So an ordinary neural network for which we've basically described all the math already and understand more or less how it works would achieve 90% accuracy on the digits, which is not too bad. On CIFAR, I forgot what the numbers are, but it's pretty bad. It's like 20-something percent. Again, there's 10 image classes, so if you made a program just take random guesses, it should get a 10% accuracy just as a baseline. So 20% is not that good. Maybe it's like 25%. but we can get up to a much higher accuracy. Like in this case, this is 58% using a convolutional neural network. And actually, the in state of the art industry stuff is actually well north of 90%, which we can't get inside of a browser because there's not enough. It's just JavaScript limitations. But this is not too bad, right? So 57 Java, pure JavaScript is doing, by the way, this is, I shouldn't say take credit, this is using a library, which is a really great library called covnet.js. It's basically an implementation of a convolutional neural network or a vanilla neural network in JavaScript, which is made by this researcher named Ajay Karpathy, who, if you follow machine learning stuff, you probably see, have seen his name around, does very active. And anyway, in any case, yeah, this is basically what we have. We can look at some of the mistakes, and this is kind of all online. This is another little, I think, little innovation from the last few days. So, like, we can look at, like, the top samples. This is, like, the top bird misclassified as an airplane. You can kind of look, it's like, that looks like an airplane, huh? But it's a bird. I like looking at cats that are predicted as dogs. It's hard to even see the cat there. These images are very small resolution. Okay, let me just see if there's any other MNIST forward pass weights, confusion, and the CIFAR forward pass we've basically already seen. Oh, okay, just to describe, I hope this works. Just to describe how it works for CIFAR. So there's one major change between CIFAR and MNIST, which is that we have color now. It turns out that there's a really simple way of dealing with this, which is to just have three times as many weights and pixels and inputs. So we just separate the red, green, and blue, and you'll see that in a second. There we go. Okay, actually, this is wrong. CIFAR images have 1,024 pixels, so there's 32 by 32, so there's 1,072 pixels, and each pixel has a red, green, and blue value, and so the way you would set up the network is to have, like, pixel 1 red, pixel 1 green, pixel 1 blue. You would just separate them, basically. They would all become inputs, and so there should actually be, this looks like there's 1,024 neurons in the input layer, but there would actually be 3,072. So there'd be three times this many inputs, and then that's it. That's how you deal with color, basically. So not really any different. Cool. This right here, this forward pass, is a vanilla neural network. So we can actually see how well it does. So the one that we were just looking at with confusion matrix has a really good performance. This is going to be considerably worse. Yes? Mm-hmm. Yeah. You can do that, but actually for most techniques now, I think for the most part they don't do that. They just try to, at least for techniques based on convolutional neural networks, they just use the color. Because, you know, we get rid of color, usually, like, computer vision techniques get rid of color because they're interested in finding things like contours and edges, and that becomes their representation, so color doesn't matter exactly. But here, you know, we don't want to get rid of the color because there's a lot of information in color. So you can learn a lot about ships by observing that the images have a lot of blue in them, and you'll see that, like, that's one way that they can start to get a sense for ships. And airplanes, actually. Airplanes and ships get confused a lot because blue sky, blue water, I think. We can see this is a regular neural network, and you can see the performance is actually much worse. So that's a mistake, correct, mistake, 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 mistake. So you see it's, I think that's just about good. So it's not too bad, but it I think it's like 20-something percent accurate. Okay, so let's get into convolutional neural networks. So, let me just back up real quick, just to wrap up about neural networks. So, So that's I think that's more or less what we want to talk about with neural networks. A lot of the exciting new stuff that has been coming out is using a type of neural network called a convolutional neural network, which makes some innovations to what we saw just now. And I'm going to describe them kind of at a very superficial level today, because we're going to cover them in more depth later in the course, like around week four. We'll cover these in a little bit more detail. So if this description that I'm about to give you makes no sense, just know that's okay, because I'm just trying to give like a sort of presentation view of it, and then we'll do like a much more thorough look at how CoVNets work in week three, I think it will be. So for the rest of today, because we're now going to be sort of more like a presentation, you can kind of relax because it should just be, we're going to see a lot of eye candy to try to get you excited about some of the really cool things about CoVNets.
How soon after the lecture do you post your video or
something? Maybe what I'm going to do first tonight is email everyone, and just to get everyone's if anyone has an issue with me posting them. Actually, let me just say right now, basically, if you guys if you have any issues about these being posted online, especially like for those of you whose voices are appearing, please email me. I'm going to email you guys after course today, probably tonight, with maybe the assignment and some more of the stuff that we're sort of figuring out. And I'll remind you guys, but basically, so long as no one has any problems with it, the screencast that I'm doing, which I hope is recording, I think it's recording, I'll just post it online, probably, I guess, on YouTube. I don't know, I'll have to figure out a good way to share. Probably just put it on YouTube. And at least for the time being, I'll make it private at least, so then just share it with you guys, and then when they're maybe a little more robust, I might put them online, basically, because lots of people have asked about that. I would expect basically tomorrow this should be. Okay, so CoVNets. So these are convolutional neural networks in progress, classifying MNIST digits. Convolutional neural networks are a type of neural network which have actually been around for a few decades, really. They were conceptualized a long time ago. But they really only became kind of useful more recently, because for a long time we kind of struggled with training them. So training, as I said, is the central problem in scientific research about machine learning. We talk about how we need to have the correct weights in order to make the right classification. Well, finding the correct weights is not super easy. It turns out to be really difficult for computers to do, because there's so many weights. And so in some sense, that's kind of why for a long time these were failing, because we just weren't able to train them effectively, because there are certain things about them that make them hard to train. But they have kind of a simple intuitive structure, which I'm going to kind of describe, again, superficially, because we're going to cover these more in more detail later. Basically, the idea with convolutional neural networks, and I should say it also before we talk about them, they achieved fame in the 90s kind of first, because professor here at NYU, in fact, named Jan LeCun, you guys know Jan LeCun, he's in the computer science department. These days, I think he's much less active at NYU, and he's also the head of basically AI research at Facebook now, but he's also a professor at NYU. And he was one of the first people to kind of convolutional neural networks to train effectively. And they solved a problem in the 1990s of digit recognition. So I showed you how neural networks got, let's say, 92% or something of recognizing handwritten digits. But to use them industrially, you need to have a much better accuracy of that. And I think they basically got to 99.8%, I think, accuracy to classifying MNIST handwritten digits using a convolutional neural network in the 1990s, I think late 90s. And for a time, it was the system that they developed was being used to read like 15 or 20% of all checks that were printed in the US. So if you printed a check in the 1990s, it would be read by a machine, which would figure out the numbers you put into it. So of course, it's going to make some mistakes, but probably not any worse than a human. So we've been able to do handwritten recognition pretty effectively for a while now. And the way convolutional neural networks work is that they're everything that we just described about neural networks. So they have all the same features that we just described, but then they add a few features. They add a few different kinds of layers, in fact, which I'm going to describe again superficially, but in more detail in week three. First of all, just to say, CovNets are everywhere these days. So self-driving cars use them to classify and find obstacles so that the cars don't move into them. They're used, I mentioned this earlier, they're used for speech-to-text technology is using CovNets. DeepMind, the Google DeepMind that defeated AlphaGo, basically, that defeated the top Go player in the world. That was just last week, basically. It also uses convolutional neural networks. It uses it other things as well. So this is sort of an ensemble system, which we may talk about a little later in the course. But it uses convolutional neural networks. And all of the crazy visual applications that you saw, this is Deep Dream. This is a picture of Memo Acton, who's an artist who is using Deep Dream. They're using convolutional neural networks. So we're going to describe them and spend a little bit more time later in the course talking about them in more detail. So I'm going to show you like a demo of how they work. So the intuition, and this is the one demo that I don't have ready for today. In fact, it might not even be working properly. My convolution demo is broken. Okay, so that's okay. Basically, because we'll do this more carefully in week three. So basically, this is how a convolutional neural network works. We start with an input image. Doesn't have to be me, could be anything. Actually, maybe it'll be better to just get this ugly face off here and put a dog in instead. All right, good. Come on. All right, great. So we input in this image of a dog, and you see all of these smaller images. They look like what appear to be sort of edge detection, right? These look like they look a little bit like the outputs from what are called Gabor filters. If you've ever done like some computer vision stuff, Gabor filters are like edge detection filters, and so. Like this one right here, and you can see they all look kind of different. So this one has like sort of vertical lines, this one has horizontal lines. This one has maybe sort of slightly diagonal lines. This one is kind of weird, it has like, maybe it lights up for like patches of consistent color, or maybe light color, you know. So they all look kind of different from each other. And the way these are produced, each of these, and there's actually, in this particular CovNet, there's 96 of them. They're produced using the following process. We take a sort of filter, which we can view here. So there's 96 of these. Okay, so there's one for each of the images that we saw. There's a little 7x7 pixel large filter that looks like this. And so imagine we take this one right here, and we kind of take it and we slide it across the image. So we kind of take this thing, it's much smaller than the image, right? We can slide it across this way, then move down one row and slide it across this way. And every time we slide it, it's overlapping with some 7x7 pixel subregion of the image, right? So when we do that, and at each point, we do the same thing as we did in a neural network. We do like, these are weights, right? These filters, they're like our weights. And we multiply these weights times these pixels, and we add them together, and then that gives us a final value for the corresponding pixel in this in this thing right here. So this we get if we take this image right here and we slide it across this thing and take the output responses and then we plot all the values here. So, yeah?
What happens exactly when you slide?
Like basically we take each of these pixels. So every time we slide it, this thing, which is 7x7, is overlapping with some 7x7 region of the input, and then we multiply them together and sum them into one pixel. So all of these, actually, you know, there's a good visual of this is from here. You can kind of see what's going on. Like every, so these are the feature maps that we were looking at, and this is the original image. And a region of the, like a small subsection of the input image is associated with a single pixel in the feature map. And there's 96 of them. So there's, here there, you see there's a bunch. There's nine, there'd be 96 in our system. And again, like I just want to, again, just to reiterate, like we're going to do this much more. We're going to actually show this process in week 3. So if you guys don't quite understand the entire operation, just don't worry about it too much right now because we're going to do it much more carefully. But the basic idea is that now we are, every image in the response is actually a function of multiple pixels in the input image. So it's kind of like it takes a bunch of pixels, which may have some features to them, edges, gradients, things like that, and it will give us a response, right? And the way to interpret these weights is that they're in very much the same way that we were looking at those MNIST weights. They're basically like these filters which are looking for parts of the image which are sympathetic to the filter. So like you can see this one has like basically three sort of diagonal lines. So if we run this fourth filter over the image of the dog, well, this one's not so good because the responses are very low, but it's basically looking for places where you have sort of like three diagonal lines that look like this. So they're like edge detectors. They're looking for things that look like themselves, basically.
And those filters are created through the training, like they...
Yes, yeah, that's important. So, yeah, these filters are not like handed down from God or anything. They're actually found through the process of training. Which we'll see, yeah. And it's kind of interesting to watch them be found because a lot of times, like, when we get into visualization, that'll make more sense. So each of these are generated, and then so this process is it's just like the neural. We can think of it as very much like the neural networks that we showed before, except we don't connect all of the input neurons to all of the next layer's neurons. We actually just connect subsets, and we also share weights among them. So we like the filters are slid across, so like the weights are stay constant, which is so we're basically looking for the same features in all of the images. I keep using the word features, and I haven't really said very much about it. It's sort of an abstract term that we use a lot in machine learning. Features are basically like you can think of it as like summaries of data. Like it's like if you have data, data is explicit, but data may have certain features, which is sort of like how different data points interact. So features in the context of images could be things like at a low level they're edges. You know, like okay, edges are features of images. You can also say that mouths are a feature of images, right? So that's like a high level feature. And the whole idea behind convolutional neural networks is that they're trying to discover these. So the process continues. So let me go through the rest of the process. So we get these responses, right? And then don't worry about this, actually the whole local response norm. It's just a normalization, so it just takes this and normalizes it. And then the main thing, the next thing is what's called a pooling layer. Pooling layers are extremely simple. They just downsample. So you see that it looks like it's the same size, but it's actually been downsampled. So there's half as many pixels. I just draw them at the same size. But you see See the correspondence. The pixels are bigger now, so there's half as many pixels. Pooling basically is a downsampling method that takes our these responses, and let's say the responses have, you know, 50 by 50 pixels. It'll make them 25 by 25 pixels, so it'll reduce them. And the way it reduces them is it takes every group of 4 pixels, and it just takes the biggest one, and that becomes 1 pixel. So it's just a simple downsampling technique. So it takes the features that we found, the edges, and it reduces them to a smaller, like a smaller image size. It turns out, actually, more recently, there's been research that suggests that these pooling layers are not even necessary, that we might be able to just replace them with more convolutional layers. So, which is really interesting, because like you could see that like by the time that this class is over, that part of it might already be obsolete. So that's just to give you an indication of how fast things are moving. Anyway, so we have this pooling layer, and then we do another convolution on top of it. So we take this as our these all as our input images, and again, this is going to start to get weird. But basically, like you take all of these, there's 96 of them, and you remember in our images, like how we have three colors. So you can think of it as like three channels. We take all of these and we make them into one big super image with 96 channels. So it's like all of these, but its thickness is 96 layers. It's the same as, it's sort of like RGB, except there's 96 of them. Again, like if that's all, if it's starting to get a little abstract, don't worry, we're going to look at it more carefully in the future. But basically, yeah, we concatenate them together, and then we do the same thing. We have a new series of convolutional filters, which I actually don't have drawn here, but they also start to not become more abstract in that sense. But we do this sliding operation again, and we do this another convolution, and we get another response. And now this response is interesting. So if we look at it compared to this one, right? This one is, first of all, it's half the number of pixels, so they're smaller. But also, like, let's think about, you know, you can kind of see the outline of the dog and everything in them still. But the things that are lighting up, they're a little bit harder to interpret. So before, like the first time we were interpreting them, we were like, oh, they're just edges that are sympathetic to the filters, right? But now it's the same thing, except they're filters that are sympathetic to the outputs of the first filter. So they're almost like edges upon edges. And remember, not necessarily edges, but really just features, like groups of pixels that have a particular pattern. So this is, again, it's getting into really heady sort of abstract territory, and it's really hard to sort of demystify it. And all of us, like I struggle to understand this also. But the way you can think of it is that it's creating sort of like composition. Pixels become edges. Edges become groups of edges which have some particular properties. And their feature, you can think of them as higher level features. So now they light up according to a more abstract sort of signal pathway. That might be a sort of a pretentious way of putting it, but yeah, if you have a question.
Yeah, what is our ultimate role with this picture? After we put it through all the processes?
That'll be the last layer. I'll get to that, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's on the way.
Understanding.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, maybe I should have put that up first, we're almost there. So these are lighting up according to these sort of compositions.
Does it use the same original filters? Or
no, it uses different filters, which may also have different sizes also. And all of those things, like how to choose the sizes and so on, those are all basically like arbitrary things that people have figured out how to do, and we're not going to cover in too much detail. So we do the same operation again, pull them, and then we do another convolution, and another convolution, and another convolution, then pull it again. And now we look at these filters and they're just blobs, right? They're just huge pixels. And what's interesting about them is that now they're really hard to interpret, right? They're like, you know, like you might look at this one and go, oh, that looks like it's lighting up where there's a face. right? And maybe some of them have this. Like, I often look for ones that light up only for faces. Like, this one might be a good one. It's hard to tell because we'll need more. Actually, we can go back to the webcam. Yeah. So this is doing it live. And sometimes I'm able to find one that I think is a face detector. And what I mean by face detector, maybe this one. See, it seems to be white only where my face is. And maybe if I put my hand in front of it, it doesn't really light up, right? So it's not like a skin detector. It's hard to say. It's a little abstract. But basically, like, the way we can interpret these now is that because we've done these multiple layers of convolution, the features that it's finding are abstract. They're like, it might actually be lighting up for things like faces. So things that contain eyes and mouths and noses, and not for simple things. Like, it's not lighting up just because it's skin. It's lighting up because it's a face which contains eyes and noses and so on. So this is like the idea with convolutional neural networks, where regular neural networks fail. Convolutional neural networks are able to sort of create this sort of compositions. And we get these pixels which tell us abstract features about the images. Now, it's almost common. We're getting to the punchline. So then you see FC0, FC1. So it's very typical for convolutional neural networks, once you have done a bunch of convolutions, for them to then have a fully connected layer at the end. So fully connected layers are like what are the things that we looked at with regular neural networks. That just means that all of the neurons connect to all of the next layer neurons, right? And very often you can see it actually here. So this is our feature maps at the end, and then it just goes into like a regular layer neural network. Like, all of these pixels just get dumped into one big long line of them. Just going back to the demo, all of these get dumped. So there's 96 times however many. They get dumped into a big fully connected layer, and then it's really, really long. It has 4,009, because there's 96. So there's 96 filters here. I think there's 96. No, there's actually more. There's let's see if we can count this. There is 256, and each one has 6 by 6. So 6 times 6 times 256. Did I do this right? Sorry? I think I have. Yeah. Actually, I think I might have my math wrong. No, let me. I'm going to verify that later and then come back to you. But basically, I believe this has 4,096, this fully connected layer. And they look like this. Now, what's interesting looking at them is that, like, you see how invariant they are. You know, like, certain pixels kind of stay pretty consistently high even when I move around, right? So they're detecting things that are in the image even as they move. So this creates what's called like translational invariance. But actually, if Jeff Hinton were here, who was one of the like sort of pioneers of convolutional neural networks, he would correct me and say that it's equivariant. Equivariance, not invariant, but equivariant. Or something. Basically, the point is you can move around a little bit. Like, things in the image can move, and it still finds sort of the same things. And then there's actually yet another layer. So this one's hidden, and then there's a final layer, and then the final layer takes our 4,000. It has 4,096 elements, and then it does, and then it plugs in finally into our output layer, which in this case, this is trained on 1,000. It's the 1,000 classes. I forget the actual data set that was used, but this is basically has 1,000 classes, and it's doing a live prediction, and it's not actually a very good one. WIG. That's great. Actually, the first time I looked at this, I had really long hair, and I was like, okay, you have a wig. Yeah. So it's doing a final classification. Wig, plunger. We can actually, okay, so it usually works really well with, like, a cell phone. iPod, hooray. Yeah. Okay. cellular telephone and so on. And like, I forget some of the things that it has. We like tried it with shoes the other day, and it's really, it has lots of animals in it. So like, actually, it'll like, if we load this picture of the dog. Dog. I have a bug here in the image. Is that a bull terrier? No, it's a beagle, right? Someone told me it's a beagle. So it's wrong, but not bad, right? These are all a bunch of dogs that it thinks it found. So it happens to have a lot of images of dogs. By the way, this is the back end of this is all running on Open Frameworks, and this is an add-on. How many people here use Open Frameworks? Couple people? Okay. This is an add-on for Open Frameworks that is a convolutional neural network that I'm working on with Kyle, who will be here later. Not today, but in a few weeks. So this is like basically an implementation of a CoVNet in Open Frameworks. So we have this working pretty well. So for those of you who are interested in using this, this will be something that definitely encourage you to use this. We're developing more features as we go. It does a pretty good job of class, not too bad, right? It has 1,000 different classes, so not too bad. And it does it live, so we can kind of, sort of brave new world. If anyone has any other objects they want to try, maybe another laptop? I've never tried another laptop. Can I try your laptop? Let's try this. Look at that! Experience
RTC. This would be so useful for a project I've been wanting
to do. Oh, yeah? Cool. Okay, I've got one that I did myself. If I can find it. I think it's this. I hope it works still. Okay, so if I put this on my iPod. So it's searching Instagram for the tag of the first classification. So these are all tagged iPod. That this is just like recently. I think they're all commercials, basically. these are just like little fun things that you can do. You can now think of like, oh, what are all the cool things that you can do if you have a computer that's able to figure out what's in front of it at any given time. This data set is weird because it has like lots of animals and like random household objects and stuff, but it may not have the thing, you know, like you might have to look at all the classes and see what they are if you want to make use of it. So that's basically convolutional neural networks. Yeah?
How much of all the downsampling is because it's part of the technique, and how much is just because it's trying to manage the amount of data that's coming in?
It's kind of both, I guess you could say. I think like it's definitely it's useful. So like doing the downsampling is a way of accounting for the like movement of things. I think that helps. I suppose maybe it's not necessary. I don't know, actually. I shouldn't say too much because I think that's like that's a difficult question to answer. I think there's a little bit of both. And also we're seeing now that like maybe pooling won't be even in future convolutional neural networks. Actually, recently, just this past week, I've been seeing a lot of writing that's saying that in the future, convolutional neural networks will be purely binary, which would be totally new. So just zeros and ones. Because apparently they have lots of interesting properties and work really well. I haven't seen that in practice, but yeah, everything is moving so fast, so I can't tell. I can't say too much. So let's talk about visual. Oh yeah, yeah.
What's the reason of the final layers to be squashed together?
The reason for the final layer. Because those are the ones that we're looking at, the FC, those are fully connected layers. Those are all unrolled. The only reason I had them in a grid was just to fit them, because there's like 4,096 numbers, so I just put them into a big rectangle. Yeah. Mm-hmm. We can talk a little bit about visualizing these. So there's a lot of interesting things you could do. Some of the first people to kind of start working on visualizing these things were this researcher by the name of Matt Zeiler, who he and Rob Fergus, I think, also at NYU. I believe they were at NYU. I have to figure this out. Incidentally, I'm actually based. He started a company called Clarify, and I'm going to that right after this class, so I can go ask him. But I think he was at NYU. But anyway, they won ImageNet competition in 2013, and Matt Zeiler did a lot of work with kind of figuring out ways of visualizing them. A little bit in the way that, you know, we were showing those MNIST weights. There's a lot that you can kind of learn by looking at the internals of convolutional neural networks too. And this will get important because this is sort of like the background to all of the cool things like Deep Dream and so on. So one basic thing you can do is you can visualize, like, okay, so we do this classification, right? So like, let's say I put the iPod in front of the screen and it classified an iPod, right? One thing we might be interested in learning is which parts of the image are responsible for making it classify as an iPod, right? Well, we see that it's this, right? So this is the iPod. But there's all this other stuff in the image, right? So like, so the question becomes, which part of the image generates the iPod classification? So you can do these experiments where, like, you can take this dog, for example, as a Pomeranian, and you have just this gray box, right? And you can sort of move it, slide it across the image, occluding different parts of the image at any given time, and then measuring the response for Pomeranian. And you can see that when you put this thing, the gray box, in, if you occlude the face of the Pomeranian, if you put it here, roughly, the suddenly the activation, or what's called the activation, is like the, I use a lot of these words interchangeably, so sorry about that. Activations, responses, outputs, they're all sort of mean the same thing, like the value of the neural network in a particular place. Yes?
I'm sorry, I'm doing a break.
Do you guys usually do breaks and 2.5 hour classes? I've been rambling, right? Oh, you guys do? Okay. Well, here's the thing. We only have, like, only 20 minutes left. So starting next week, we'll do breaks. sorry about dragging through. Yeah, there's a lot to cover. We'll end, like, a little bit early today so I can talk to people about, like, registration issues. Maybe that might be a good use of time. I'll go another, like, 20 minutes or something. Is that okay? Oh, that's good. Oh yeah, sorry about the break thing. We'll start doing breaks
next week.
So you can do these images where you slide, you know, you occlude parts of the image and measure the response. So you can see how that works for the Pomeranian. You can also do this technique where you, and I'm actually still struggling to understand this myself. But there's a certain cluster of techniques called deconvolution. There's also something called guided backpropagation. They're all like different techniques for generating images, which tell us a little bit more about the activations. So like these show like it's kind of like a way of finding which pixels, like what is the sort of archetype of the weight. It's a little bit like what we were looking at with the MNIST weights. Except once you get many layers deep, you can't really do that anymore because they become too abstract. So the question is, like, can you visualize, like, what is a particular filter looking for? You know, that's, like, a really interesting question, and this is a much better look at that, right? So if you look at the first layer, it's really easy to see. Like, you put in different images, and, so there's these 9 weights, right? So these 9 quadrants here... I shouldn't call them quadrants because there's 9. There's these 9 sections show, each of them show 9 pictures which responded really well to each filter. So like the top leftmost one, do you see sort of like 3 diagonal lines? You'll see all of these sort of look like that filter and they responded highly to it. And you can do the same thing at layer 2 now. So these are now layer 2 neurons and parts of images which responded well to those. And you see that they have they look a lot like the same thing. And then the thing on the left, and again, we're not gonna, we can't we just can't talk about this too much right now because I don't understand it enough to talk about it eloquently myself, not yet. But also just because we don't have enough time. But basically, the way you can think of these things, and we'll talk about deconvolution, is that it's kind of doing this process of like backpropagation from the outputs to the back to the input, except not to fix the weights, but to fix the images themselves, which we're gonna get into more, and that'll be the really fun stuff actually. If we look more layers down, the features become progressively more complex. So like these are looking for, it looks like they're looking for birds basically. These are dogs and so on. So this is sort of really, really cool, fun stuff. So this gets into deep dream. So the thing that I just mentioned, right? Really interesting question, right? The question is, okay, so like let's say you feed an image into a convolutional neural network, you observe all the responses, and you go, oh, it found some of this and not so much of this, right? Well, a really good question to ask is, what would be an image? What image could we produce that if we fed it into a convolutional neural network, it would have a particular type of response that we're looking for? So like, for example, we have all this classifier that can tell us if something is a dog. And it tells us it's a dog and this much of a cat and this much of a, you know, wig or whatever. So a question to ask would be, well, what would be an image that would be really, really high for dog and really low for everything else, right? So if you start asking that question, you're basically starting to ask questions of like the decon stuff and deep dream. So how many of you guys are familiar with deep dream? Anybody not familiar with it? Okay, a couple people, all right. So last year in June, this picture surfaced on Reddit, on the website Reddit, on the machine learning subreddit. Someone basically just posted it anonymously and wrote image generated by a convolutional neural network. And Reddit was like a big scandal, like who could have possibly made this, like what is it? And basically about a week later or so, Google came out and they unmasked themselves and said they produced it. This was actually leaked by some anonymous Googler, I think. And basically they talked about the thing that we were just showing, so like this idea of visualizing what images would produce particular responses. So they have this big convolutional neural network model that they call inceptionism, which helps them do all of their crazy applications of image classification stuff. And they say, okay, what images could we synthesize that would give us a really high response on starfish? Right. So I'm looking at starfish right here, and if you look at it, like you can see what's going on. We see these sort of weird, abstract-looking starfish-looking things, and this would respond with really highly to ants. And you kind of see the ants in there, measuring cups, heart of beasts. Actually, this picture is cut off. I don't even know. Oh, this is like a parrot, I think. This is a banana. This one's cool. This is a parachute. So you see something interesting? There looks to be a person attached to that parachute. So that's really interesting because, like, if you give a neural network a whole bunch of pictures of parachutes and you say these are all parachutes, but most of the pictures of parachutes that Google has have people attached to them, it will kind of start to associate people with parachutes. And they have another example of this with dumbbells. All of their images of dumbbells have arms attached to them, and so on. So this is kind of a neat thing. And you can start doing, and so like the whole idea of deep dream, we're going to cover deep dream later because it's super cool. But the whole notion of deep dream is like this. So like you can take an image and then do this sort of back propagation, and this sort of alternative to backpropagation, where instead of backpropagating to change the weights of the network, you backpropagate to change the pixels of the image so as to enhance the responses that the network originally received. So you throw this image into a neural network and it sees a particular things in it, and then you adjust the pixels so as to maximize its response in particular layers of the neural network. And what's cool about it is that you could do it at any layer, right? So like if you do it at the very last layer, you know, which has all the image classes, you'll start to change skies and clouds into things like this, like these weird bird looking dog, fish, snail, you know, all these bizarre creatures. But you can also choose to enhance low layers of the network, which are just, you know, gradients and lines and edges and so on. And then you get images that look like this. So that's kind of cool. These are images produced by Mike Tyka. He's one of the engineers at Google who produced DeepDream. And he did a whole bunch of really awesome work with DeepDream where he started experimenting with a few techniques that people started riffing on. One was feeding it noise. So instead of feeding images of, you know, actual photographs, you just feed it, you know, pure straight up noise. And it will produce all these crazy, like, you know, it'll, the network's got to find something. You feed it a whole bunch of random pixels and it'll have mostly flat responses, but it'll find something. And then it will start to produce more of that thing. And if you put it, and if you do this sort of a feedback loop, it will find something, basically. And then you could do these other techniques where you could do these feedback loops. I think I have one of these. Let's just look at a few. These are just a bunch that I did when the whole DeepDream stuff happening. So you could see, like, these are different artists. You know, Egon Schiele, Edvard Munch, The Scream. These are, like, fireworks. This happened around July 4th, so I did a whole bunch of fireworks. These are just, like, some of my vacation photos. It's pretty rad, right? Yeah. This is what DeepDream does. This is done by a convolutional neural network. We're going to describe how this works in more detail. Yeah.
Can I ask one question?
Yes?
Why, like, overall pictures become, like a painting, like?
You mean, like these?
The next one, especially. Next one,
yes. This way, or?
The last one. Of the, like, some of the...
This one right here?
Yeah,
the Indian one.
Which one?
Water.
Further ahead, I think.
Further ahead?
The last one.
Your vacation photos.
Yeah,
this
last
one?
Yeah.
Oh, at Lake Ndaji? What's a painting? I don't know. It's all a bunch of pixels. I don't think it's a painting. It may look like one, but it's just finding things in the sky. I like this one. This is Da Vinci. See the dogs everywhere. You can do videos too. So, like, if you do basically this feedback process where you crop the image and then you start zooming in infinitely, it starts to just, you know, make all sorts of crazy. And you can do all sorts of experiments. I was just doing different experiments, like, okay, oscillate the layers. So, enhance high layers. And then enhance low layers, so it'll blow up whatever it sees, and then tries to, you know, it's basically oscillating between which layers to enhance. You can also train, like, other people. I didn't do this, but other artists experimented with training their own sets. This one artist named Mario Klingemann, like, produced basically made deep dreams of typography sets. So he just started embedding letters and characters into things. So he did a lot of really cool work. At some point, I started seeing this everywhere. Style transfer is next. I'm really rushing now, so I'm gonna kind of say this really briefly. Style transfer is very similar to DeepDream in what it's trying to accomplish, except it gives you sort of 2 degrees of freedom. So it says, okay, can you apply the style of one image onto another image? So, like, this is Mona Lisa recomposed as Picasso, Van Gogh, and Monet, right? And, like, this was the original paper it's based on. So I'm just gonna show you a whole bunch of. We're going to learn all about this, so I'm going kind of fast, but these are all, like, different ways of recomposing the Mona Lisa in all these different styles. Kandinsky. You could do, like, I started using, like, instead of paintings, like, different other sort of things. Egyptian hieroglyphs, I kind of like. Google Maps, everyone usually likes a lot. I did a whole bunch of these. QR codes, Rosetta Stone, Ryoji, Akita, TV broadcast, signal, noise.
Now my dear,
I produced a video like of Alice in Wonderland.
Oh, yes.
Basically, I took a scene. You can do video also. So with video, it's kind of just a frame by frame approach.
I
and I basically produced it just took 17 different styles and I applied them to the scene from Alice in Wonderland. There's been a long time. You mean like compute time? Yeah, cause so at the time, this has gotten faster since then, but this was in September, and each frame took about 15 minutes or so to produce. So basically, it was like 6 machines times... I forget, there was like 2,000 hours of total compute time or something. That, yeah, it's really rough, yeah. No, sorry, not 50 hours or something.
Is a raven like a writing desk?
In theory, you could do it on a laptop. Actually, Style Tracer works pretty well on a laptop. But like to do them at a large scale, you basically just need a good GPU. So GPU, this is all GPU stuff. We'll talk about that.
Well, I'm sorry, but I just haven't the time.
But anyway, yeah, just doing more videos. I'll show you these all later. These are all online also. So you can see, you can do more, like I was just doing lots of different videos. This is Picasso on Picasso. You can also do these style interpolations. So these are like three of his styles sort of in being interpolated one to the other. His own styles, and that's a video of Picasso. Doing feedback loops and just lots of other experiments. This is another thing I want to talk about. Deep convolutional generative adversarial networks. Okay, deep convolutional generative adversarial networks in 1 minute. So these are like, this is a type of framework that basically uses two convolutional neural networks, which are sort of locked in competition with each other. And in a way that I'm barely struggling to understand myself. But basically, like, one is responsible for producing fake images that look like they came from an original image set. So if you look at all of these images, they were trained on a data set of bedrooms, and now these are all fake images of bedrooms. They look pretty convincing, right? And like if you look at them closely, they all look kind of weird and surreal, but they really do kind of look like bedrooms. Sorry? They're fake images. They're totally fake. They're like hallucinated by a computer. And they're hallucinated using these DC GANs, Deep Convolutional General Adversarial Network, and they have some interesting properties. They have this sort of, the generator is controlled with a latent space, it's really hard to describe in 1 minute, basically like a latent variable that's like 100 or 1,000 dimensions or however many you want, that lets you, it's kind of like Perlin noise. If you've ever taken like a processing class, imagine Perlin noise, like, when you move along the Perlin noise field, you change the output a little bit. This is like Perlin noise, except in 1,000 dimensions and really abstract dimensions. So changing the generative properties of these things. So you can smoothly change these images. So like you see, this is one image of a bedroom that is morphing into another one. And so you can see like the like windows turning into doors and so on. So all sorts of cool stuff. I'm just going to skip through a lot of this stuff. Well, again, all of this stuff, I'm skipping through it, but we're going to look at it more closely in future weeks. You can do arithmetic on these, like generative arithmetic, which I don't have enough time to describe. You can put sunglasses on people and do these kinds of, and the interpolations can be animated. So like you can generate, you could use it to generate fake numbers. So MNIST, here are original MNIST numbers, and these MNIST numbers are fake. These are actually not written by humans, but they're produced by machines which have looked at these and have learned how to produce fake ones. And then you could use the whole generative technique to create interpolations of things. So I made this like basically just an interpolation of using a DC GAN on top of these MNIST numbers. So I made this a few months ago or something. And I did this project with where I found a data set of Chinese characters. And I did this project, it's called A Book from the Sky. So I'll show you this all a little bit more detail later. But this is on my website where I basically applied DC GAN to a whole bunch of handwritten Chinese characters from a data set collected in China. Simplified characters written down by people. Again, for the sake of optical character recognition, these are actual samples. And then these, the left-hand column, are real samples next to their generative counterparts. And you can see that the ones on the right, pretty much they start to look weird, like especially for complex characters, but they become, but they're actually like reasonably convincing. And so these are all fake. These are fake, and they're kind of bad maybe, but they're good enough that you can do things like this. So this is doing like interpolations of these characters that you can animate. So these are all hallucinated by a machine. These are like Chinese characters that are being produced by a machine. And then doing these sort of loops in the generative space. Again, I'm not doing a good job describing these because I don't have time, but we'll cover these in more detail later. These are, yeah, you can see what's going on here. Just doing these sort of interpolations between characters. And it's finding like, it's not just crossfading, it's actually trying to find like reasonable fade-in, or sort of reasonable morphing, you know, like one line on the side goes to a line in the bottom and so on. So this is sort of a fun project that I was able to apply. There's another thing, like more specific to people who read Chinese will appreciate this, like the radicals that Chinese characters are based on are often preserved in the interpolations, so that's kind of a neat thing. That I found. You can do also arithmetic on this. This is like a little bit. I didn't include this in the in the final, but because it was too much. T-SNE. We're going to cover this when we talk about unsupervised learning. So T-SNE is a dimensionality reduction technique, which takes data sets that look like this and reduces them so that they're only two or three dimensions in which the interpoint distances have been preserved, so that you can do like. You can basically cluster related things together. So, for example, this is watching. They're really fun to watch converge. There's a nice reveal here at the end. But basically, what it does is it finds like an optimal 2D configuration of these points, such that similar colored points appear next to each other, right? So that's kind of what's happening here. And so you can do it. For example, apply it to images. So imagine you take all of these images of animals that are collected from Caltech 256, this animal data set, and you run them through a convolutional neural network, and you grab the final activations. There's 4,096 numbers, which describe the images in, you know, like abstractly, these abstract representations of the images, which should be similar for similar images. So you have two images of dogs, they should have similar activations. If you take these and you reduce them to 2D using a technique like T-SNE, which we'll cover in week 3, I think, or week 4, you will produce, you can then do this data visualization where you can basically cluster related images together. So you see all the elephants are together, all of the owls are together, and, you know, birds and parrots and cacti and so on, hummingbirds. Flowers, there's a big data set of flowers. All of these are similarly organized. I got lots of contributions for people. So this is a student of Golan Levin's, and with Golan at CMU, Carnegie Mellon. They took the entire catalog of IKEA. This super high resolution. So it's really neat. I got other contributions, data visualization, an artist named Morris Steffener, I think I'm pronouncing the name right, took a data set of Impressionist paintings and clustered them. These are satellite images done by Zach Lieberman. Lots more contributions, Blair Neal, grocery store items. So you can see these are like from, there's like 10,000 here, so this one's really big. You can apply it to text. So these are a bunch of Wikipedia articles, this is online, that are all clustered together according to a text analysis. So all the feminist articles are here and all the Marxist articles are around here. Different political ideologies basically, and I'll show you this when we get into like the natural language stuff. This is kind of neat, but I won't
show
you.
We present a novel
real-time facial reenactment
method that works with any commodity webcam.
Ago.
Since our method
so
only
like,
uses RGB data for both the source and target actor, we are able to manipulate YouTube videos in real time. Here we demonstrate
sort of
our method
like,
in a live setup. On the right, a source actor
face
is captured with a standard webcam.
If you look for face
this input
two,
drives
face,
the animation
you basically,
of the face in the video
have a
shown on the monitor
for controlling
to the left.
Like someone's facial gestures.
A significant difference to previous methods is the re-rendering of the map.
We'll get into that. It's not.
We present.
I want to actually wrap up here, and just say so. Like for today, I'm going to. We'll put all of this online really soon, and I'm going to share the notes and the assignment. We will. And I'm gonna send you guys an email later today, or tonight, maybe tomorrow morning, about the assignment, which will probably just be some reading for this week. And how to share the materials and so on. Does anyone have any questions? Okay, I know I need to talk to some of you about enrollment stuff. I'm just gonna stop the record.